Well, good evening. Good to see y'all back here tonight. Hope you enjoyed the service this morning. Invite you to stand and sing, "You Are Stronger." Good evening. Welcome back to Trinity Baptist Temple tonight. God is stronger. He's our Savior. We have to count on Him. There's a verse in the Bible that says He looks around and He says, "There's none else. He is the only God, our God." Love you guys. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Let's pray and we'll bless our offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you in prayer. We just thank you, dear Lord God, for being such a great God. We love you so very much. You're so good to us. You do so many things for us and with us and through us. You use this body of people, dear Lord God, to accomplish your will. Help us to serve you the best that we can. We love you, Father, with all of our hearts. We pray, dear Lord God, tonight that you bless this offering that's taken. Help those that give and those that may not be able to understand that it's for your work, for your kingdom, for your glory. And dear Lord God, we ask that you bless it in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen.
Singing good tonight, so stand and sing again with us. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
forget. After I wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend. He met the need of my heart. Shadows are spelling with joy, I'm telling. He made all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away.
soul ever long for everything he's promised and so much more. It's more than amazing, more than marvelous, more than miraculous could ever be. Just to know he really loves me. When I think of who he is and who I am, for he's more wonderful than my mind can conceive. He's more wonderful than my heart can believe. He goes beyond my highest hopes and fondest dreams. He's everything that my soul ever longed for, everything he's promised. So much more, it's more than amazing, more than marvelous, more than miraculous could ever be. He's more than wonderful, that's what Jesus is.
Right there. It's awesome. Praise the Lord. Well, welcome back this evening. If you got your Bibles, turn over to Philippians chapter 2. Not going to be very long tonight. We've got a fellowship afterwards. Excited to go over there and just spend time together and eat a little bit more if you ate some at lunch. Praise the Lord. In our last message in Philippians, the Apostle Paul was expressing this great need that need to be realized by the Philippian believers, but also by us today, of this obedience and shining our lights in a crooked and perverse nation. There's a lot of truth that applies to us today, because look around, there's a lot of crookedness and perverseness in the generation in which we live. And again, he was telling them this message he was given to the Philippian believers is just as applicable to us today. But they were, and they are, these messages, something that is eternal. God's word is eternal. One of the things that we left off with last week was all things were to be done without murmuring and disputing. And this was a difficult thing for some people, because it talks about not arguing not talking against each other, tearing each other down. And then finally, he gave a charge in verse 16, and that was to hold forth the word of life. This was something that was to be done so that Paul's labor wasn't in vain, so that the work of Christ wasn't for naught. And that's something that is to be understood. Hold forth the word of life so that the labor is not in vain. And that's kind of what our responsibility is still today, is that we hold forth the word of life. Because there's been men and women, even still today, that are giving their life's blood for the gospel of Jesus Christ. The apostles did it. Again, this was the apostle Paul writing once again from a Roman prison. And he was given his life for this cause and the labor that he had gone through for the cause of Christ. If those Philippian believers and other believers since them, even up to our point, our time, don't hold forth the word of life, then there's labor that was in vain or for naught. Because it has to be carried on. It has to be passed on. Without any further introduction, let's pray and we'll continue. Father, we come before you. We thank you for this evening, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity to once again open up your word. God, to be together in one accord in your word, Lord, to be instructed by you. Lord, I just pray that we would grasp that even that song that was just sung. Lord, you're more than marvelous. You're more than amazing. And that's something that's just phenomenal to me, Lord, that you're God Almighty, and yet you choose and you have chosen to continue to use us, as we just saw, to hold forth the word of life. This evening we ask that you would speak to our hearts, Lord, that we would be receptive. Lord, there's things going on in our lives. We had a break in between this morning's service till now, and Lord, I pray that we'd be able to set aside distractions. God, we wouldn't think about the fellowship afterwards, that we wouldn't think about what's going on this week. But Lord, for the next few minutes, Lord, we would be able to focus on your word and what you have for us. And every single one of us in here will walk away just strengthened, encouraged, maybe even challenged or convicted, whatever's necessary. God, we ask that you would do in our lives, and we'll be sure to thank you for it and give you all the praise for it. In Jesus' name, we ask it all. Amen. So look, if you will, in verse 17. This is the continuing on of, again, what we left off with last week. Verse 17, he says, "Yea, and if I be offered upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all, for the same cause also do ye joy and rejoice with me." Now, there's no doubt that the Apostle Paul had this realization that while he was expecting to be released from prison, there was a reality that he possibly could be giving his life in this Roman prison, or this would be the end of his life. And again, I think that he expected to be released. We'll see that in just a second. But I also think that Paul expected to be alive at the time of Christ's return, because he says that in Thessalonians, "We which are alive and remain at the coming of Christ." You know, he is including himself, expects to be alive at this point in time. But Paul's not, he's not oblivious to the realization or the fact is that he might give his life for the cause of Christ. And in this thought, he rejoiced. And he asked them to rejoice as well, to be an offering for Christ. For the Apostle Paul was an honor. And so he says, "Listen, I do rejoice, and I want you to rejoice with me." I think our perspective today is a little different. If we think about having to give our lives for Christ, if someone were to begin persecuting us here in America, and we had the idea of having to give our life for Christ, I don't know that rejoice would be the word that came to mind. You know, I don't know if that we would be thinking, "Oh, great. You know, we get to get persecuted today, you know, and possibly get thrown into jail and may even die today for the cause of Christ." That's not the mentality that we have as Americans. But the Apostle Paul says, "Listen, this is a realization. I'm giving my life for the cause of Christ." We already saw before that for him to live was Christ and to die was gain. And he wished that he would be taken on, but he realized that it was beneficial for him to stay for the Philippian believers, for the continuing of the gospel cause. And so he had this realization. He said, "Listen, I joy and rejoice with you all." And he said, "For the same cause also do ye joy and rejoice with me." Listen, this is a part of God's plan. Even if he takes it by my life, we saw this already, that he said, "Whether it be by my life or by my death, that Christ is glorified," or that he's magnified in my life. And so, move on to verse 19. He says, "But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timotheus shortly unto you, that I also may be of good comfort when I know your state." Again, from a Roman prison cell, think about this. The Apostle Paul is concerned about the state or the condition, the welfare of these believers that sent to him care from Epaphroditus. We'll see that in just a second. But His concern was of their mental state, their emotional, their spiritual condition. And again, his hope was that he could send Timothy very soon so that he could find out what their state was and bring that back to the Apostle Paul and give him comfort. I don't know about you, but there's times that I've gone through trials that I'm not, and this is bad, I'm not saying this as a boasting, this is not good, that going through trials, you're not thinking about other people. I think that if we're honest in here, most of us would raise our hands and say, when I've gone through huge trials, I'm not really thinking about others. I'm thinking about the difficulties I'm facing, the emotions that I'm going through, the struggle that I'm facing. And I'm not thinking about others. I'm not thinking about what somebody else is going through or what even my trial might be causing for someone else. But that's what the Apostle Paul was doing. That shows us this great, unimaginable love he had for these Philippian believers, for the cause of Christ. He had led these people. Again, we saw where this church started with Lydia and the Philippian jailer. He had this great affection. He had spent time with them. And the apostle was so concerned about them in his prison cell experience. And I think that's just a lesson for me, and I think a lesson for us, that when we're going through things, you know what? We can still care for others. We can still do what God wants us to do. But again, what happens? We begin to go through stuff and we begin to shut down. We begin to isolate ourselves. Nobody knows what I'm going through. Nobody feels what I feel. Nobody knows. And we begin to pull back and begin to isolate. And that's not what, again, the Apostle Paul is setting an example for. He's saying, listen, I want to send Timothy to you because, and I want him to go to you quickly. I want to be able to do this shortly so that I can hear of your state and I can be comforted. He was concerned about them. And again, this is a great lesson for me and all of us, you know, to continue on. To realize that people are still needing the gospel, that the work of Christ still continues on, even in our prison cell experiences. And so it goes on in verse 20, it says, "For I have no man like-minded," describing Timothy here, "who will naturally care for your state." He's saying there's not even one person that I have around me on my missionary team, in this prison cell with me, or who's able to come back and forth, that's as like-minded as Timothy. I don't have anyone like him. There's nobody who will genuinely care for your condition like I will, other than Timothy, he says. And so that's why he's going to send him. The word like-minded in the Greek means equal in soul. It means that their souls were knitted together for the same exact purpose and cause. It was as if God says, listen, I'm putting you two together to accomplish this great task. Doesn't mean that Paul didn't have other people, because exactly who we're going to see in just a second was a great co-laborer, was an amazing blessing sent from God, was an instrumental part of the gospel ministry. But he says, listen, there's someone who has this genuine care, and it's a gift from the Holy Spirit, and it's Timothy, and I'm going to send him to you because he has this great genuine care for you, just as I do. He's competent, but he's not only competent, he's willing to serve the Lord, serve his church, serve even the apostle here. So verse 21, he goes on and he explains what he was facing. Because listen, Timothy is like-minded. He has the same care and concern for you that I do, and there's nobody else around. So where is everybody else? Where's everybody else's mind? Where's everybody else's heart? Where's everybody else's concern? If Timothy was the only person that Paul could find, where was everybody else? Why wasn't there somebody else? Oh, well, I can send him. I can send even her. Hey, she come along, so she can do that, you know. And that, why was it just that one person? He says in verse 21, "For all seek their own, for all others seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ." And we know that Paul at one point in time was forsaken by Demas. He says that. Listen, he's gone off and he's pursued the pleasures of this world. He's forsaken us. We know the experience that they had on the missionary journey, the first missionary journey. John Mark, along the way, he goes back to Jerusalem. It gets too hard. He goes back home. It ends up becoming a source of contention for him and Barnabas, and they split ways on the second journey. And so this is something that is very important. He says, listen, there's only one person I truly know that has this like-minded, this oneness of soul for the cause of Christ. And I hope to send him shortly, because he is going to go and have this genuine care for you just like I would. And I want him to come back and give me the comfort explaining your state. And he's the only one I got to do this, because everybody else is seeking their own thing, not the things which are Christ. And I want to say this. That statement could fit in today's culture quite well, couldn't it? I think sometimes if you've ever been in that place before, you're really trying to serve God and you're really trying to do what God wants you to do, and it, maybe it's your family or friends or even other people in ministry or maybe in your Sunday school class or just whoever, and it doesn't feel like nobody wants to get on board. Nobody, maybe they were on fire at one point in time, but you weren't on fire. But now that you got on fire and you're ready to do this, there, nobody else is around. You feel isolated, that isolated state again. And that's what Paul's saying. Listen, there's everybody's kind of seeking their own thing. They're constantly seeking their own affairs. They're on their own agenda. All without exception, they were striving after the things that mattered to them, their own things. Paul doesn't say that they're not saved. He wasn't questioning their salvation. He just says, listen, there's only one person. Everybody else is seeking their own, not the things that are Christ. And again, I think we look at America, especially American Christianity today, and that's a lot of what we see. Even in churches, a lot of what man wants. I don't want to, why can't we do it this way? And it's a lot easier. Why do we have to do it this way? Why is it like this? Again, the truth was that some would only help if they could see it gain them in some form or fashion. If it was compatible with their philosophy or for their pattern of life. And again, that's the same truth today. There's so many that will say, I'll do this because it fits into my schedule. Or I won't do this because I don't like to do that. Or I'm not comfortable with this. Or I'll do this because it's something I enjoy doing. Again, this is what Paul was facing in his day. There were so many that were searching for their own way, their own objective, their own plan, their own goal, for their own gain maybe. And again, Paul found so few that were willing to have that like-minded heart for that same cause that he was willing to rot and die for in a Roman prison. He says, but Timothy is. Timothy's willing. Timothy's got that heart. Nobody else I can find has that. And it just makes me wonder, man, how close is the church today? How close am I? Is it something that we're doing today that's so much about ourselves? Or is it all about, listen, God, just you want to do it your way? He goes on to verse 22. He says this, but you know the proof of him. That as a son with a father, he has served me in the gospel. The proof of him. What does that mean? You know the proof of him. That means he's proven. He has proven worth. It's that specimen that's been tried, that's been proven, and has shown its worth. And there's something to say about testing. You know, a lot of times we want the easy way out. We want the quick way through things. We want things to happen fast in our time. That's the world we live in. I preached a message one time called Convenient Christianity. And I said, that's the world that we live in. We push a microwave button, and in a minute later, there's 6 chicken nuggets warm, ready to eat. You know? And it's like, wow, that's the way all of our life is, right? We just get saved, and we're the spiritual giants, you know? Or I say I want to do this, and I should be able to, you know? Or this happens, and that's, you know, that's kind of our mentality, I think, even in our spiritual life, is we don't get that proving process. How that proving process comes about is in various ways. One of the ways is through the trials, is through the testing, through the storms, through all those things, exactly what Jesus allowed. Hey, go to the other side. You're not going to come with us, and I'll meet you on the other side. And what happens? In the middle of the sea, there's this huge storm. Jesus knew what was coming, but he knew that they had to learn a lesson in the storm. Trust me. Rely on me. Don't try to do it your way. Don't try to work it out in your own wisdom. Don't try to do these things. Just rely on me and let me be your God, because that's what I want to be. That's what I died to be. And so this is what Timothy had done. He had proven himself. He was sitting with Paul in a Roman prison. He said, I want to send him to you shortly. He had been faithful. He had endured. He had been proven. And he had shown himself, man, through thick and thin, through the good and bad, through the ugly and the beautiful, he has been there. And he's still there. And he's fighting for the same cause. And so he goes on to verse 23 and verse 24. He says, him therefore, talking again about Timothy, I hope to send presently, quickly, so soon as I shall see how it will go with me. But I trust in the Lord that I also myself will come shortly. So as soon as Paul knew what was going to happen to him, again, another admission to this reality that Paul was facing. Listen, I may die in this prison. I may be sent to the execution. I may be hung. I may be beheaded. I may be crucified. I may face these things. But I want to find out how it's going to go with me first, and then I'm going to send him. But here's my expectation. I'm planning on coming to see you myself. I'm planning on the Lord delivering me and me being able to come to see you guys. Verse 25, yet I supposed it necessary to send you Epaphroditus. So here we have Timothy, this like-minded person. This person has endured, he's been proven, he's been tried. He has done the work, and he's been faithful in it. And Paul says, listen, I'm going to send him, but I'm going to send him on an important task because I may have to send him with the news that I'm going to die. And so he's going to be able to be the one that's going to bear that news to you and care for you and comfort you. He's the one that's going to be able to come back to me and say, listen, here's where they really are, Paul. Here's where they really are. And so Paul said, listen, I need to find out what's going to go on with me, then I'll send Timothy. But I'm sending Epaphroditus back with this letter. I'm going to send him back, and here's who this person is. And so we're going to get and see who this Epaphroditus is. In the introduction, the first sermon in this study, we looked about who Epaphroditus was. This is kind of how Paul got this news. This is kind of how this was brought about. And so we'll get into see this person, Epaphroditus. It says, I suppose it necessary to send you Epaphroditus, my brother. Listen to these words. And my companion in labor and fellow soldier. See, Paul did have somebody, but Epaphroditus was sent from the Philippian church, the city of Philippi. But on his team, there was no one else that he could find other than Timothy. But Epaphroditus, it didn't mean that Epaphroditus wasn't someone that God wasn't using in an amazing way. Again, he's saying, listen, he's my brother. He's my companion. He's my fellow soldier. And he says, but your messenger, he's your delegate. Your church sent him with the authority that you have to me. And he ministered to my wants, my needs. This tells us that Epaphroditus had a very specific mission. Epaphroditus was sent for that cause, to minister to Paul's needs. Why? On the behalf of the church. We saw here recently that the authority of the local church was something that Jesus Christ instituted. That we see everything coming out from the local church. We talked about that God didn't ordain the rogue church services that happened here. And oh, we had church here, we had church there. No, unless it's sent from the church. Epaphroditus is a great example of one of those things that he says, listen, he's your messenger. Paul's the one that won the people there, and the church started there. But this church had already begun to have these people, and it already was established. The authority was there. And so he said, listen, he's your messenger sent to help my needs. And this is something that we have to get. Again, this is something the church had done in sending him. Again, a minister is someone who ministers. A person sent to minister acts as an official, an officiant, if you will. Often engaging in priestly services. Well, Epaphroditus was an official ambassador. Doesn't mean he was a pastor. Doesn't mean he was a preacher or teacher. He was just a delegate sent by the church for a certain work. And he could have taught. He could have preached. He could have won a lot of souls to the Lord. We don't have that record. But he was sent by the church, commissioned, and he was appointed for this responsibility. But Paul goes on to explain this heart of Epaphroditus. And Epaphroditus, listen to what it says. For he longed after you all and was full of heaviness because that ye had heard that he had been sick. Again, this is that thing that's so instructional for us. Here's this guy that is sick. And well, in a second, we'll see how sick he was. But he was sick, very sick. And he was distressed and full of heaviness, not because of his sickness, but because the church that had sent him out had heard that he was sick. And he was worried and full of heaviness. Man, I don't want them worrying about me. You know, they sent me out to do this job, and I want to do this because of the gospel of Christ. I have all this responsibility laying on me, and now they're worried about me. I'm supposed to bring them back word for how the Apostle Paul is, and they're concerned about me. They need to be focused on the gospel. They need to be focused on what God wants them to do, not concerned about my sickness. I'm willing to give my life for this cause. We'll see that in just a second. And so this is what he was at. He was distressed, full of heaviness, because they heard he was sick. And this is the truth. He became ill, but he didn't stop doing what he was sent to do. He further explains his condition in verse 27. Indeed, he was ill. Truly, he was ill, Paul says. He was ill near to death. He was deathly sick. He was on his deathbed, if you will. But God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. I am the more eager to send him, therefore, that you may rejoice at seeing him again, and that I may be the less anxious or worried. So receive him in the Lord with all joy and honor such men. I'd like to ask the question here. In light of what we saw in our study on Sunday mornings, we talked about apostolic gifts, and we talked about the gifts of healing, the gift of miracles, the working of miracles. And we saw the Apostle Paul in Acts perform some miracles, an exorcism, some healing. And Paul's in a Roman prison, same apostle, and a fellow soldier, a co-laborer, a brother in Christ, someone who's so dear to him, is sick, nigh unto death. Why didn't Paul heal him? For the cause of Christ, why didn't Paul say, I'm an apostle, I've got the gift of healings, I've got the gift of working of miracles, I'm going to heal him. Why is it that Paul writes back in this letter that he eventually sends back with Epaphroditus and saying, listen, he was sick and he was worried about what you guys were thinking about because y'all were worried about him knowing that he was sick. Why did he need to heal him? Listen, hey, this is what happened. He came, he was sick, he was almost dying. I touched him, he rose. You know, I mean, he's good, all good. Now he brought the letter back to you. Don't worry anymore. Don't worry your pretty heads, you know. You know, I mean, he didn't do that, though. Why? Someone put it like this. I want to read this little thought on Epaphroditus' sickness. Someone said that it shows that the apostles didn't have the permanent gift of miracles. I don't necessarily agree with that. I believe that the gifts that God gave, he gave to them. But they go on to say that they didn't have that any more than they did of inspiration, which I do agree with, because we know that there was other letters that were written, but that we don't necessarily have in Scripture. So they, like us, sometimes we write letters, we write things, we write lessons and messages and emails and all that kind of stuff. Sometimes we know, and we can admit, you don't have to raise your hand, that they're not divinely inspired emails or letters or Facebook posts or tweets or anything like that. But this person says, listen, we know that they're not necessarily always used, but he says this, both were vouchsafed to them only for each particular occasion as the Spirit thought fit, and of course supplied. Which is very true. God always does things for reasons. He just doesn't do things just because. He can. He's God. And sometimes we look at things and think, well, God just did that just because he wanted to. God's not a frivolous God. He's not just, oh, he's whimsical. Oh, I'm going to do this, you know. That's not how God works. God has a purpose. He has a plan. He has a passion. And his passion is the salvation of man and his glory being exalted. He's God. So while Paul might have, could have healed him, it wasn't necessarily God's plan. And this goes, and the reason I wanted to say that is because sometimes we wonder, why doesn't God do certain things at certain times? I prayed for this. Why didn't God answer? It had to be God's will. It doesn't always work like that. God has a perfect plan. It is always for the good of his children. Jesus said that. Listen, if you know how to give good gifts to your children and you're sinful man, how much more does your heavenly Father give to you? He died for us. And so God has our good, but it doesn't mean it's always going to go exactly the way that we think it's going to go. Epaphroditus eventually gets well. He goes back and delivers the letter. We know this. But he wasn't healed that we know of by the working of miracles of the gift of healing from the Apostle Paul. So this is something that we can take a lesson in. Notice that he says, listen, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. And this tells me that this apostle that I have studied and taught his epistles for years and have grown so fond of, he is the example for me in ministry. I want Paul's heart. I want his mindset. I mean, he is, and the reason why is because I think he took on the mind of Christ. I want to be like Jesus, conformed to the image of the Son of God. I want that. But as a human example, we see the Apostle Paul. And I'm like, man, oh, I want that. But he shows us here, listen, he's real. He's human. Lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. This reminds us that him being in prison wasn't an easy thing. It wasn't something that he was enjoying in his flesh. That's what we've preached before when we read James and he says, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptation. When you go through the storms, when you go through the trials, count it all joy. It doesn't mean these things are enjoyable to our experience, but we can count it all joy. That Paul says, listen, rejoice with me. I'm rejoicing. You rejoice in this. I may be an offering poured out for the sake of Christ, but that's something to rejoice for because it's part of God's plan. And that's what he's saying. Listen, I'm real. I have sorrow inside here. I'm separated from you as I'm writing this letter right now back to you. But I'm also here. And I got one person that has the like-minded heart. Everybody else is going after their own things. And I'm kind of lonely. That's why Epaphroditus was a godsend at this point in time. Sending to his needs. Man, what a refreshment. And we'll see that too as well. But he says, listen, if he would have died, this would have compounded my sorrow that I already have with more sorrow. Goes on to verse 30 and explains why. Here's this heart of Epaphroditus that Paul says, this is why it would have been such a tragedy. It would have been so hard for me to bear that this man would have died. Because for the work of Christ, he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life, to supply your lack of service towards me. Now, he wasn't indicting the Philippians that they weren't doing their part. Matter of fact, they did their part by sending Epaphroditus and sending to his needs. He was saying, listen, I know that all of you can't come down to this Roman prison and take care of me. You sent Epaphroditus, and he was the ambassador. He was the delegate that you sent. And so, but this is one thing that I wanted to point out, is for the work of Christ, he was nigh unto death, not regarding his life. He approached death. He was at the point of death. And Epaphroditus, I believe, threw down a stake. I believe at some point in his life, maybe it was on the journey that he got sick. When he got there, he got sick and he became deathly sick. But at some point, he threw down a stake and he risked his life in service for Christ. He said, no turning back. I've decided to follow Jesus. The world behind me, the cross before me. Though none go with me, I've decided to follow Jesus. And he threw down a stake and he risked his life for the cause of Christ. For the devotion that's an inspiration or should be an inspiration to all of us. I'll give my life for that. Again, he wasn't necessarily an apostle, a preacher, a pastor. Of course he was going to do it. No, he was an ambassador sent by the church. And he was willing to risk his life to advance the cause of Christ. Why though? Why would he be willing to do that? Because I believe he counted the cost. I believe that Epaphroditus counted the cost. And I believe what we know of him shows that he was sold out. I believe we look at Epaphroditus and see a man that, man, while he may not have been the Apostle Paul, he may not have had necessarily a position, he was determined to give his all. Not part, not the convenient part, not the part that fit into his plan, as we saw a while ago. There's none that are seeking after Christ. All are going their own way. Timothy's the only one. He wasn't willing to do that. He had determined to give his all for the cause of Christ. The Apostle Paul wasn't dead, and from prison, God was still using him. And Epaphroditus was going to continue to do his part. He was an instrument. And he was instrumental in the advancement of the gospel. Because guess what? I don't know. I mean, I'm sure God would have had somebody else, but we don't know that. All we know is the church sent Epaphroditus, but who sent this letter back that we now have in our Bibles here? Epaphroditus. The cause of Christ was advanced at this man risking his own life. This man saying, listen, I've been asked to do something, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it with everything that I have, and I'm going to risk my life if I have to. Even if I die in this sickness, I'm going to give my all for the cause of Christ. And it was that willingness. It was that sold-out devotion. It was that determination, that commitment that God used and that he continues to use. Again, because 2,000 years later, you and I are benefiting and talking right here tonight about this man's example that he set for us 2,000 years ago. God used him in this sacrifice, this service, this commitment Yeah, he went through a tough time. Yeah, he went through a hard time. Yeah, he himself was facing death. But he continued on for the cause of Christ. So as the musicians come this morning, this evening, anybody had a nap? That's the question that's spinning around in my mind. Is, do we have this willingness? Do we have this level of commitment, of sold out, just a complete abandonment? Is that describe my life? When somebody says, listen, this is how I would describe. Now, I'm not talking about preference. I'm not talking about anything. I'm just saying, man, I want my life completely spent for the cause of Christ. And you say, I don't know. All I'm trying to do is just serve Christ. I'm trying to be faithful to Him. I go to church. I go to this. I read my Bible. I pray. I'm trying to witness at work. I'm trying to witness to my friends and my neighbors. Anytime the church has an opportunity, I'm trying to shine the light. I'm doing everything I can do that God has given me the opportunity to do. And I think that's what we saw in Epaphroditus. What God gave him to do, he did it. And he was willing to die even for it. What about Timothy? Are we in that group that would be considered as Timothy? Or like Epaphroditus? Or was it like that group? Would we be considered in that group that he described in verse 21? Look at it again in verse 21. For all seek their own, not the things which are Jesus Christ. Those people who are striving after, looking for, searching after their own things, their own plans, their own maybe possessions, instead of eternal value. What group would we be in? Let's pray. Father, we come before you. Lord, you can see my heart right now, and but it's not any type of prayer that hasn't been prayed in private. Lord, but you know, I just want to be used up. I know sometimes that we hold back, and I hold back apart. Maybe it's out of uncertainty, fear, insecurity, thoughts, questions. God, there's no reason that any of us should ever have to go through that. The Apostle Paul said that he knew whom he had believed and was persuaded that he's able, that you are able to keep that which we've committed. Lord, we should have no doubts. We can live our life with complete abandon, just like Paul, just like Timothy, just like Epaphroditus. But it comes down to a choice, a commitment that we all have to make. Or while we may be saved, and those people that Paul was talking about in verse 21 might have been saved, the truth is they were pursuing their own things and not the things of Christ. And I pray tonight that you would look in our hearts and speak to each heart here tonight. And if we're not truly pursuing the things that are of you, God, then help us see how temporal and how vain that is. Show all of us, God. Help us just be focused on eternity. Help us to see that through the busyness and through all the distraction and the clutter of this life, one thing remains, one thing never changes, and that's you and your plan. And if we'll grab hold of that and just live that with complete abandon, there's no telling what you would do with us. Not for man's sake, but Lord, for your kingdom's sake. It's just as Epaphroditus 2,000 years ago, he was willing to risk his life, and tonight we were reading about him as a testimony and an example for us. God, if you would use our lives like that, God, it would bring glory and honor to you. Just use us up, God. Use us however you want to. And speak to us tonight. Help us tonight. Be those people that are sold out. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll stand for just a few minutes. Why don't you come tonight and say, God, I want to be that person completely sold out. Given my all. Not my own plan, all yours.
Child of weakness, watch and pray. Mine in me, thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find
Well, praise the Lord. I want to ask you guys to remember in your prayers today and next couple days, Brother Christian, Miss Shauna, and Brother Ryan and Miss Kim are going down to Houston, and we're going down there to support them. And so you guys keep them in your prayers. They're really praying, and they need our prayers every day and our support, praying that God would open doors for them to present the burden that God has put on their hearts and the ministries that he's called them to. So I ask you guys to pray for them, and prayerfully God will open up some doors this week for them, and I'll see some great things happen from this week. So keep them in your prayers, if you will. Also, don't forget about the sign-up sheet for the outreach banquet in the foyer. And I encourage you to be a part of that. Even if you say, listen, I want to see what it's about. I've never been. I just want to see what it's about. Then come. You know, give you a dinner and be able to answer any questions that you have. And you can be a part in some form or fashion. So we want you to be a part. So if you're a guest with us, you know, I want you to be, hopefully you're going to stay in fellowship with us. And so I want to ask, if you're a guest or if you're a diabetic, if you guys will go ahead and make your way over to the fellowship hall, because we'd like for you to get first in line there. And so you guys can be dismissed right now. If you're a diabetic or if you're a guest, that means you're not a member. I want to ask our senior citizens now if you guys will go ahead and make your way too, so all the little kids and teens don't run you over. The mic. Oh, yeah. That's Brother Jason. God bless you guys. I hope that you stay for fellowship. We'd love to talk in fellowship for at least a little bit and get to know some of our visitors. And so let's pray and ask God's blessing on the food. Father, we come before you. We thank you for this day. Once again, thanking you for the opportunity to open your word, Lord. And as we saw tonight, Lord, just great examples of men that were dedicated and devoted to your cause. And I just pray that, again, you would work in our hearts. Lord, help us be those people this week that are surrendered, sold out, wholly committed to your cause. Lord, willing to even risk our own lives for your purpose, Lord. And Lord, just use us up for your kingdom's cause. I thank you for the time that we have now to fellowship and the food that we have to eat, Lord. We thank you for it, and we ask you to bless it and nourish it to our bodies. And God, just bless us this week. We ask that you would bless the Jones family and the Hendrick family. God, just do a miracle in their lives, Lord, to help them gain the support as quickly as they can so they can get focused on the needs of those that they're going to be ministering to. And so I just pray that you bless them in a supernatural way, Lord. And God, we ask again that you bless now, and we'll praise you for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.